Sam & Max Save the World, a game that has a remake coming up, and I just had the original game installed in my computer for the longest time, so I decided to finally beat it. This Sam & Max game came out between 2006 and 2007, being that it's an episodic game, Save the World being the first season and what we are reviewing here today. And speaking of episodic, this is actually a Telltale game, funny enough, way before they had struck gold with the Walking Dead series, and way before they lost all that gold and went bankrupt. So for that reason, Sam & Max fall under a much older type of point and click game, where scenarios are full of interactable items and sometimes a lot more hard to figure out puzzles. Now, Sam & Max never gets to the level of Moon Logic that a lot of these type of games had back in the day, but it's a lot closer to those than it is to the modern, much more streamlined, story-focused games. I think the biggest problem with the puzzles in this game aren't so much in their logic, but more of them being overbearing on the player. There's just a lot going on screen at any given time, and it can be hard to know what will progress the story forwards. But this also works for the game in a positive way, as it is a comedy game, and everything in these scenarios are also jokes. Sam & Max jokes mostly revolve around pop culture and politics. Being an older game now, these jokes are bound to not age greatly, but maybe because I grew up during that time, or because I still think some of these jokes still apply to today's world, I personally found this game very funny. It also helps that Sam & Max contrast well with each other, Max being the crazy and chaotic one, while Sam is supposed to be the calm and rational one, even though they're both pretty stupid, which also adds to the comedy. But your mileage may vary, especially if you're of a younger crowd. Something being a bit of a deterrent to this game, and even a little bit to the jokes as well, is the traversal. It is a point and click game, but your characters are incredibly slow moving within areas, and even worse when moving in between areas with a lot of unskippable animations. It can be very tiring, which definitely makes this game not a one sitting type of experience. In fact, I would recommend playing it at a slow pace, playing one episode one day and then another in another day. The story and length of each episode support this. Each episode can be completed in just over an hour, but the amount of exploration, and of course how long it takes you to solve the puzzles, will make the timer be closer to 2 to 3 hours per episode. Each episode has its own individual stories, but there are some hints throughout of something bigger, and they all end up connecting in the final episode of the season. The way it goes is, each one of the episodes will have their unique locations. For example, one episode has you exploring the White House, while another will take you into a VR world. But they will also share the main location of the Sam & Max office and the surrounding businesses. This shared area is where there's also some proof of continuity from the 6 episodes, as characters and their locations will be doing different things from episode to episode, and locations will have adapted from the events of the previous episode. It is nice, and it gives you reason to re-explore these already seen locations, but also give life to this world and its characters as they live their lives, and how that also tends to play into the puzzles. For example, Bosco, the store owner who will have a different personality and increasingly expensive products each consecutive episode. Graphically, it's surprisingly good looking, although you can tell its age. Its cartoony look with very round characters and world, obviously because of its age, things that should look round have a tendency to not look so round, you know, more squarish, but that didn't bother me much at all. Something that also didn't really bother me was the brownish tint to the game. It didn't bother me because there's just enough variety in the locations and colors that it didn't make it particularly noticeable. So overall, the graphics are old, but they're good looking, in my opinion. The soundtrack is pretty good. It's not winning any awards, but it fits with the game. It has that noir sound, but in a more funky and less serious way, which I think fits the game very well. Overall, it's a really funny game if you take your time with it, and still, in my opinion, looks really good. But your mileage may vary here, as I think your enjoyment of this game will hinge on your enjoyment of the comedy. And I'll be giving this one a 7 out of 10. I think the upcoming remake could fix not only the squariness of the graphics, which I'm sure they'll do, but hopefully they go beyond that and also add a faster mode of travel, maybe a way to skip some repetitive animations. There's a chance here to make this game even better, and I hope they take it. Or they already take it, because this game is coming out in like 2 weeks. Now, let me address the availability of it right now. I cannot speak for the remake because I have not played it and it's not out yet. So, we'll speak about the options right now and then I'll do a video on the remake if that turns out to be important. Especially with some of the more doubtful remakes that have been coming out lately. So, how can you play this game now? On PC, it's a bit hard. Legally, at least. The original game has been removed from Steam. My guess is that they're making way for the remaster because this game did used to be on Steam. But regardless, if you can get your hands on a reseller key or a used copy of this game, it still runs pretty well on modern machines with no issues that I've encountered, without any patches, and I personally played the first 3 episodes like that. For the final 3 episodes, I used this patch called Telltale Game Custom Resolution Tool, which allows the game, as the name implies, to run in a custom resolution, which does bring in the problem that these games were never meant to be played in 16:9, but I didn't find any game-breaking bugs in doing this. And also, the only noticeable thing that I think could throw you off is the cutscenes, as they still play in the original aspect ratio, but letting you see what's going on outside of that boundary, which can be funny as you see model just waiting to be brought into scene. If PC is not your thing, this game is still available on Xbox Digital Store and physical copies of this game for the Xbox and also the Wii don't seem to be very rare, or at least don't seem to go for high prices, and with the remake looming, they might even go down more, so who knows. But it is something you can look into, but beware, I played the PC version and that's the version I reviewed. Regardless, I hope you enjoyed this review, and maybe consider subscribing and leaving a like. And that's been it for another review. I hope you have a good one, and bye.